The Organians are out to lunch as Atari Archive celebrates its 50th video with the history surrounding Stellar Track. When I started this video series, I'd hoped that it would find an audience interested in this particular era of video games, of learning the stories behind their development and the context in which they hit the market. I'd also hoped that for my eventual 50th video I'd have something special, and thanks to the vagaries of the VCS release schedule, we have just that. At first glance, Stellar Track seems like a minor VCS release, and it is. As a Sears exclusive that absolutely needs the instruction manual to learn to play, it's hardly the first game people talk about when bringing up the all-time classics on the platform. But what makes Stellar Track interesting is that the game itself is just a single part of a much broader history of games and popular media, a link in a greater tapestry. This is the story about the early days of fandom, a struggling science fiction TV show, and working within strict limitations to produce one of the most widespread computer games ever made. This is the story of Star Trek. To set the stage for today's video, we will require a little bit of a detour to explain the history of the game that led up to Stellar Track itself. Stellar Track is one of countless conversions of a 1971 computer game written originally by high schooler Mike Mayfield, called Star Trek. And, side note, this video will be filled with footage from just some of the many takes on the game. Mayfield in turn got the premise from the American television series by the same name. Star Trek, the TV series, is without question one of the most influential pieces of media to come out of the 20th century. It was certainly not the first science fiction television series, and initially it wasn't even one of the most popular, but it was an ambitious series. Star Trek follows the adventures of the starship Enterprise and its crew in the 23rd century, and at first glance this doesn't sound dissimilar from the kinds of pulpy space adventures that had been popular since the 1930s. But Star Trek married its action with some thoughtful scripts tackling current day problems from writers like D.C. Fontana, Jerome Bixby, and Harlan Ellison, and found other ways to be transgressive for 1960s American television. This includes the diversity of its casting, as the show took the unusual step for the time of casting Nichelle Nichols, a black woman, and George Takei, a Japanese-American man, as main characters with their own agency and interests. The alien character Spock, intentionally or not, became both a sex symbol and a stand-in for the struggles that multiracial children can face, as well as the limits of considering everything strictly with logic. In the second season, a Russian character played by Walter Koenig was introduced, another unusual decision at the height of the Cold War, showing that even old enemies can become friends in this utopian future. Rather than regularly blasting their way out of problems, the Enterprise crew would do its best to come up with minimally violent, thoughtful solutions to the dilemmas they routinely faced, often speaking in positive terms about diversity and consent, the dangers of fascism, and the futility of war. Despite poor ratings, this earned the show an unusually loyal fanbase that in turn started to build itself into one of the earliest versions of what we recognize today as media fandom. Fandom for specific genres such as science fiction and certain book series like Sherlock Holmes or The Lord of the Rings were not new, but Star Trek was one of the earliest targets of fandom around a singular piece of visual media, and this intense devotion defined its audience not long after it started airing. Star Trek fan Betty Jo Trimble famously started a letter-writing campaign that saved the series and got it a third and final season, but even beyond that, Star Trek's fans, predominantly women, created fanzines and newsletters that served as an outlet for poetry, fanfiction, fan art, and articles. Fans also held get-togethers throughout the show's initial run, culminating in 1969 with the first sizable Star Trek-specific convention held in Newark, New Jersey. 3 years later, that was in turn followed by Star Trek Lives in New York, as the first such convention with actual guests. By this point, Star Trek was finally finding an audience. The show's third season gave it enough episodes to qualify for a syndication package, and the show's reruns almost immediately found a bigger audience than it ever did while airing initially. Star Trek's popularity resulted in a number of novelizations and books, a two-season animated revival, and plans for a new live-action show that would morph into the first Star Trek movie following the success of Star Wars. More broadly, the show permeating pop culture had an impact on getting more people interested in science and engineering, even leading to NASA christening its prototype Space Shuttle Enterprise and inviting the TV show's actors to attend an early glide test. It's no surprise, therefore, that Star Trek would also be of an interest in the gaming space. The third major arcade video game publisher, 4Play, put out an unlicensed clone of Nutting Associates' computer space called Star Trek in 1972, and in 1979, the Star Trek license would end up with Milton Bradley, which released its Phaser Strike game that went out alongside its Microvision handheld game system. Sega picked up the Star Trek license for their 1983 arcade game and subsequent home conversions, and GCE had it for its own Star Trek game on the Vectrex. But Star Trek's own legacy in the gaming realm starts earlier than all of these, with a personal project by high school student Mike Mayfield. In 1971, Mike Mayfield was a high school senior living in Villa Park, near Irvine, California. He was interested in computers, and according to interviews with myself and historian Ethan Johnson, managed to steal a timeshare user account to access the computer lab at the nearby UC Irvine campus, where he got to access their SDS Sigma 7 and DEC PDP-10. That was where he discovered the seminal 1962 computer game Space War running on the PDP's vector graphics monitor, as well as a version of the 1969 text game Lunar Lander. As an avid Star Trek viewer in these early days of its syndicated run, these got him interested in making his own space combat game. At the time, Mayfield was trying to teach himself the basic computer language out of a book, so as a teenager, it seemed doable to him. The only problem: the stolen user account he was using as a high schooler only gave him access to the Sigma 7's ASR33 teletype terminal. If you're unfamiliar, a teletype is essentially a keyboard, monitor, and printer all in one unit. The user would type in commands, and the computer's response would be printed out on a ream of paper. Later in the 1970s, teletype terminals would pop up that used simple monitors instead, but for obvious reasons, a teletype system is not conducive to a fast-paced game like Space War. Rather than give up, Mayfield got together with three of his friends and brainstormed ideas on how to make their own space combat game within the limitations of the teletype and his burgeoning knowledge of BASIC. While most of their ideas weren't workable, a few ideas stuck. Having a galaxy map and smaller sector maps that the player could travel around in an 8x8 grid, and phaser weapons that depleted your energy supplies as you used them. Mayfield started working on the game in earnest over that summer once he'd graduated high school, iterating on it bit by bit over the weeks. With no disk space allocated on the computer itself, he had to save the program on a paper tape each time he'd worked on it. The terminal also could only print out around 10 characters a second, forcing him to keep the program small and prevent feature creep from setting in just to ensure that a single game didn't take entirely too long to play. By the end of the summer, his first version of the Star Trek game was more or less complete, coming out to what he remembers as being about 4 or 5 pages of code. Mayfield's Star Trek game puts players in the role of Captain James Kirk commanding the Enterprise. Hostilities have broken out between Kirk's government, the United Federation of Planets, and the Klingon Empire. For some context, in the show, the Klingons were the rival power to the Federation that was harsh, warlike, and periodically a thorn in Kirk's side. The Enterprise has been ordered to patrol a section of the galaxy divided into 64 quadrants, and yes, I know that the term therefore doesn't make any sense. And these are in turn subdivided into sectors. Your goal is to destroy all Klingon warships and protect Federation outposts. In service to this task, players have to warp around the galaxy, scanning the quadrants to search for enemy ships, manage their energy and photon torpedo supplies, and resupply as necessary. The Enterprise can attack Klingons with their phaser banks, which always hit but use the ship's finite energy supply and weaken with distance, or with photon torpedoes, which do massive damage regardless of distance, but are a finite resource that can also miss their targets. The game is over when the Enterprise is destroyed, time runs out, or all the Klingon ships are destroyed. Mayfield said that the idea of a galaxy map that shrunk into quadrants and sectors wasn't just him working around the limits of the Sigma 7 teletype. It was also his implementation of the Star Trek philosophy of exploration. The Enterprise would need to head into unknown space to see what's there, whether that's Klingons, friendly outposts, or just a bunch of stars. And while long-range sensors can tell you how many of each of these may exist in a quadrant, it's not until you enter it yourself that you can really see things in detail. While Star Trek was popular among Mayfield and his friends, as well as the other users at the UC Irvine Computer Lab who tried it out and asked for copies of the finished game, it's likely it would have been forgotten if not for a serendipitous decision by Mayfield to purchase the Hewlett-Packard HP 35 calculator, which began shipping in January 1972. Mayfield mentioned to the people at the sales office in Santa Ana that he'd created a Star Trek game for the Sigma 7 in BASIC, and they asked if he could convert it to the HP BASIC version used on their computers, notably the new HP 2000C, so they could play and use it for their software library. Given that his original code was both messy and largely incompatible, Mayfield essentially rewrote the entire game, finishing it in October 1972 with a final revision making its way to the HP Public Domain Program Library around February 1973. Between HP 2000 timeshare computers being a relatively affordable mini-computer option, HP's BASIC variant being a prevalent computer language on them, and Star Trek quickly growing in popularity in general by that time, Mayfield's game started to spread quickly. Shortly after the original's appearance on the HP Program Library, independent variations started appearing at universities in Philadelphia, Texas, California, and more. In the code itself, Mayfield credited it to Centerline Engineering, a name he'd come up with in case he'd ever started his own company. What really got Star Trek spread outside the HP ecosystem was when then-DEC employee David Ahl came across the game. Ahl said somebody, likely a fan of the game as Mayfield said he'd never interacted with Ahl himself, submitted it to the Digital Equipment Computer Users Society, or DECUS. Ahl worked with three others, Mary Cole, Ira Patel, and Leo Lavender, to modify the HP 2000 BASIC program to RSTS-11 BASIC, which DEC's computers use. Ahl noted at the time, HP and DEC basically dominated the education market for computers, meaning anyone at a school or university that had a computer probably had access to one version or another of Star Trek. Furthermore, when Ahl published his first edition of the book 101 Basic Computer Games in 1973, he included Star Trek under the name Space War, for copyright reasons, he explained, though the subheading for the listing makes it clear that this is based on the TV show. This first edition of the book sold 10,000 copies, spreading Star Trek far and wide among anyone with access to a computer. One person who notably got a copy of this book and Star Trek was Bob Leadham. Leadham explained to me that he was a radar systems engineer at Westinghouse and had access to a Data General Nova 800 when he got a hold of Ahl's first edition book. Westinghouse allowed staff to use the Nova after hours to make their own programs or do whatever else they felt like with it, and as a subscriber to People's Computer Company, a periodical published by a computer store by the same name, Leadham was becoming familiar with the broader world of computer programs. With Ahl's collection of games in book form, Leadham went through and converting them to the Nova 800 form of BASIC, and as a big Star Trek fan since the show debuted, he was immediately interested in Mayfield's game. He said that he found it to be one of the best games in the collection, but he and his engineer buddies wanted to add some quality of life changes to the game. While at this point Leadham doesn't quite remember which ideas were his and which came from his group of friends throwing out suggestions, Super Star Trek included several changes that would find their way into quite a few future versions of the game. For example, Leadham felt that the original's method of requiring players to memorize specific numbers for the commands was cumbersome, and so added in text shorthand for commands that were more intuitive. Klingon ships would now move around, and status reports would come from named members of the Enterprise crew. The quadrant misnomer was dropped, with each region of space now named after star systems or constellations. Proud of his changes, Leadham wrote a letter to People's Computer Company about his updated game, which was published and then spotted by Ahl, who at that point had left DEC and was publishing Creative Computing magazine. Ahl contacted Leadham, got a copy of Super Star Trek, and had it published in Creative Computing. Moreover, when Ahl left DEC in 1974, he got permission to take 101 Basic Computer Games with him, with the minor change of removing the 101 from the title, and the major change of redoing all the programs within it for Microsoft Basic. It was during this period of time that Ahl met Gene Roddenberry himself, who in turn got Paramount Pictures to agree to let Ahl use the official Star Trek name in the second edition of the book, free of charge. When Ahl published this second edition of Basic Computer Games in 1978, right as the home microcomputer market was starting to take off, with each machine featuring its own take on Basic, both Mayfield's Star Trek and Leadham's Super Star Trek were both right there at the right time. This was coincidentally right after Star Wars had hit theaters in 1977, and when the revival TV series Star Trek Phase 2 was being turned into the motion picture on the strength of continued original series reruns, so space-themed games were absolutely in the zeitgeist. They weren't the only Star Trek fan games to be developed over the decade. For example, the also notable Trek 73 takes a more narrative approach than Mayfield's game, and pits players against Klingon ships in a more enclosed space. Nevertheless, Star Trek and Super Star Trek would by far become the most prolific. Between Al's books, enthusiast magazines, and the program libraries from HP and DEC, the stage was set for Star Trek to pop up on practically every computer platform, and it did. Including those early variations and conversions of Super Star Trek, the game can be found on practically every single computer platform that was in use during the 1970s and 80s across parts of the globe with access to these still niche machines. With multiple people writing into newsletters and magazines about their versions for everything from the PDP-8 and Altair 8800 to the Commodore 64 and Cosmac VIP. It even spread to the non-English speaking world. In an article published in the Japanese computer magazine OMZ in September 1984, the author Junji Minegishi describes the history of the Star Trek game in Japan, where the show had started broadcasting in 1969 and similarly found a niche fan base there. The game was first discovered by Haruhisa Ishida, who encountered it at the US-based Bell Labs in 1975. Inspired by Mayfield and Leadom's versions, and particularly by one written for Palo Alto Tiny Basic called Tiny Trek, Ishida created Micro Trek after he took a position at Tokyo University the following year, which would get ported around to Japanese computers, such as the PC-8001, MSX, and the Sharp MZ line. It's a little unclear exactly how far Star Trek spread in Japan, but all indications are that quite a few versions were floating around by the time that article was published. On the home console front, Stellar Track is preceded by several versions of Star Trek that made their way to the Bally Professional Arcade through its basic cartridges. Of the six or so we know of, a couple were published as type-in programs and newsletters, some were sold on cassette tape, and still others were just homemade renditions that didn't get much spread. But regardless of where they originated, many of these are still extant and preserved today. These games seem to be sourced from a few different takes on the game. For example, the earliest, an unpublished variant likely by Brett Bilbray, is an attempt to directly convert the 101 basic computer games listing, as is a May 1979 version by Scott Baldinger. Another pair of games, the March 1979 Bally Trek and the 1980 Micro Trek, both stem from the version 4 Tiny Basic, and are stripped-down programs with only one weapon system and a warp function that automatically jumps you to the next area with enemy ships. Micro Trek, incidentally, shares the name of Ishida's game, and reportedly is a take on a game shared around by the TRS-80 user group out of North Carolina, though I haven't been able to confirm that this is indeed based on the Japanese version. Another author, Mark Keller, wrote a now-lost conversion of Super Star Trek in early 1980 before revisiting and revising it for Star Trek III the following year, ostensibly adding in features from the more narrative-based Trek 80 variant to produce possibly the best version of the game on the platform, if one prone to crashing. There are also a few games that take the concepts of Star Trek into new directions, taking advantage of the action-oriented Bally to produce more active programs. The Bally Arcade always straddles the line between a home console and an early microcomputer, and the number of Star Trek renditions made by users really drives that point home. And finally, even though Star Trek and Super Star Trek were functionally public domain programs, some versions ended up as commercially sold software, with or without the official Star Trek license, on computers ranging from the Apple II and Atari 8-bit line to overseas units such as the British ZX Spectrum and Japanese PC-88. It's this commercial grouping that today's game, Stellar Track for the VCS, falls into. Stellar Track comes to us from Rob Zdybel, and is his first VCS game to be published. Zdybel was a former chemistry major who fell in love with computers in college, changing his major and never looking back. His first couple jobs in the industry involved working for the US government, which is when he first discovered and enjoyed the Star Trek game while working with NASA. With this background, when he finished school in 1979, his first job offer was to help design software to make missiles more accurate. Deciding that he wasn't a fan of a job that was about killing people more efficiently, he opted to go into video games instead. He ended up taking a job with Atari after they offered him a free Atari 800 computer for signing on. Zdybel was a big proponent of the 800, its architecture and ease of use, but since there were no openings at the time for an Atari computer developer, he found himself making VCS games instead, a platform he found to be much more limited and less interesting. At the time he started working at Atari, there were few restrictions on what developers could make. Essentially, whatever the game dev thought would be fun, they could work on. With no bonus programs or recognition of any sort, he wasn't all that worried as to whether or not Star Trek would sell on the VCS. Zdybel has noted in our interview and in his convention appearances that he pretty much would take the entire month of December to stop working on his main projects and instead develop Atari 800 programs for his own enjoyment. This included a version of Trek 73 called Tech Trek that Atari would eventually republish itself in the Atari Program Exchange. And unsurprisingly, Star Trek became his first VCS game as well. The VCS is a weird fit for Star Trek, and Zdybel describes it as a technical challenge and tour de force. He recognized that there were few strategy games on the VCS, and with no one to stop him, as he put it, he decided to attempt the conversion. One major problem that had to be overcome for the VCS is that the system has no native text display mode. Zdybel had access to the same static character display kernel that Warren Robinette used in Basic Programming, and much like that program, a large chunk of the system's memory went towards maintaining the screen. While the game probably could have used the keypad controllers, this would have limited its audience dramatically, so Zdybel put together an interface that used the standard joystick. More vexing was the need for the game to generate random galaxy maps and locations. While the VCS has a built-in counter that could normally be used for a random number generator, Zdybel said that for whatever reason, no matter what seed he put in, this counter would produce one of three maps. As such, he had to write his own random number generator code to get that aspect to work correctly. The VCS game also reduces the size of the galactic map from an 8x8 grid to a 6x6 grid, presumably to fit within the resolution of the screen and the paltry available memory on the VCS. Despite the VCS being a strange platform to host the game, Zdybel did an admirable job with this conversion. The joystick allows the player to flip through the various menu options along the lines of Super Star Trek. Short-range scans that show your current sector map, long-range scans that tell you the number of aliens and starbases in the surrounding quadrants, the galactic map that shows you everywhere you've been, the warp function that allows you to move by selecting a course from one of eight directions and then the number of quadrants and sectors to jump, the status menu showing you the time remaining and your ship's current condition, and both your phasers and photon torpedoes. At the start of every game, the cartridge will generate a random map with varying amounts of aliens to destroy and time to do it in. The manual recommends that beginners reset the map until you end up with between 25 to 35 aliens and as much time as you can get. The difficulty switches will adjust whether or not the alien weapons are as powerful as yours and how likely you are to receive system damage. If a system is damaged, it can't be used until the necessary amount of time passes or unless you dock at a starbase, of which two will be randomly placed in the galaxy. If engines are damaged, you need to enter the equivalent number of stardates needed to fix them as your warp factor, which will cost time and energy. And time really is the most precious resource here. Warping between quadrants is the only action that will use stardates, one for each quadrant jumped, but it means that you need to be very strategic in how you approach your path through the galaxy. You also need to ensure your course out of a quadrant is clear, since trying to warp with a star in your path will cost you all that time but get you nowhere. Thankfully, moving within a sector doesn't use very much energy and no time, but it's still very easy to run out the clock and lose the game. Combat is pretty straightforward in this version of Star Trek as well. Each alien ship has 99 units of energy that you must deplete before it's destroyed. Much like Mayfield's original game, phasers will target all enemy ships in a sector divided among the total amount of energy the player chooses to expend on the attack. The closer the alien ships are to your starship, the more damage the phasers will do. Photon torpedoes, by contrast, are a limited resource that can only be fired one at a time, and even then can only be fired along one of eight possible directions. With this said, torpedoes will instantly destroy an alien ship, so it can be worth maneuvering into a position where you can fire one. But any action the player takes in a combat zone, aside from checking the galaxy map or the ship's status, will give the alien ships an opportunity to fire on you. This even includes doing a short-range scan to even figure out where they are in the sector you just warped into in the first place. So much like warping between quadrants, it's important for the player to carefully judge their actions to lose as little energy as possible in a fight. Now this said, docking at a starbase will replenish your energy and torpedo supply and involves little more than moving the ship on top of it, but if a starbase is out of your way, it presents a dilemma on if it's worth using the time to get there unless it's an emergency. The game ends when all the aliens are destroyed, the player's ship is destroyed, or if you run out of time. In any case, the game then rates you based on your performance from Cadet to Admiral. Overall, Stellar Track does a really good job of bringing this computer game to a home video game console that frankly would have been the cheapest way to play it in 1981. Granted, at this point, Star Trek was a decade-old program, but it's still a fun game, and the randomly generated seeds provide as much replayability as any other version of the program has. The VCS doesn't have a huge number of outright strategy games, barring its supply of board game conversions, but this is a really good one. Much like the other versions, there's a little bit of randomness to your victories. Success or failure can depend both on the seed you get to start with, where the alien ships and space stations end up being located, and whether or not you get hit with an untimely systems failure or damage. Particularly when the game is set to make system damage more likely, it's incredibly easy to warp into a quadrant, get damaged as you scan your surroundings, and then find yourself without the phasers or photon torpedoes you need to finish off your enemies with the time you have available. At the same time, it's so easy to get a new game going that death doesn't really seem all that severe a penalty. So even when the game is a little unfair, it still goes by quickly enough that you can hop right back in and give it another shot. In a modern context, you could refer to this as a roguelite type of game. But regardless of classification, it works. While this game follows championship soccer and steeplechase and having a backstory fleshing out the game in the instruction manual, it moves away from the Mad Magazine-inspired goofiness from those titles in favor of a pulpy sci-fi setting. This spins a tale where Terrans trade science and art for alien warp technology, ultimately leading to tensions between the two sides. It's all a tad flimsy, but given that your justification in the original Star Trek was little more than putting one ship up against a Klingon invasion fleet, it certainly as good a background as one could reasonably expect from a few paragraphs. The Star Wars-esque TIE bombers in the manual art, on the other hand, may be notable as being the first time that franchise served as inspiration for a VCS game, though other games such as Exidy's Starfire arcade machine or Cosmic Conflict on the Odyssey 2 pull from that franchise's visuals before Atari did. Being a Sears exclusive, we don't really have sales figures for Stellar Track, but the game did see a little bit of coverage in the press at the time and seemed to have gained some interest by virtue of being a space game in the early 80s. Atari Analog from May 1981 remarked upon the game's publication alongside Steeplechase, though it did not review the game itself. In the August 1982 edition of Space Gamer, reviewer Richard Edwards immediately identifies it as a conversion of the 70s Star Trek game, and writes that the joystick makes moving through all the menus easy and the game retains the interest of the original, but he also points out that Star Trek itself was long in the tooth by 1982, and that paying full price for a VCS conversion is a hard sell. A recurring theme that we'll touch on further momentarily. In December 1981, the Munster Times published a roundup of game software and referred to Stellar Track as a game that would give Captain Kirk a challenge. Naturally, both it and Steeplechase show up in Atari's contemporary catalogs, as well as in Sears' own game advertising. So while it was not a huge release for the company, it did still get some marketing boosts. In all, Stellar Track is something of a blip in the broader history of Star Trek, both in terms of the game and the broader franchise. While this is probably the most high-profile commercial release of the game, Zdybel said that when he wrote it, he assumed Atari would be willing to go after the Star Trek license so that the game could be sold under the name of the popular series. Obviously, that never happened, possibly because of the exclusivity deal with Sears. While he himself refers to the game as Star Trek, officially it only came out under its Sears title, Stellar Track, appearing admittedly like the store brand of the franchise that it is, right down to the Enterprise-esque ship on the box art. But what really leaves Stellar Track so easily overlooked is Atari's other game inspired by Mayfield's Star Trek, Star Raiders. Star Raiders wouldn't show up on the VCS until 1982, but it was one of the earliest game releases on the Atari computer line, which launched in around November 1979, with Star Raiders showing up at some point between then and April 1980. An absolute technical showcase, Star Raiders put players in the cockpit of a starship that, like in Star Trek, was searching sectors of a galaxy map looking for enemy ships while balancing energy supplies and protecting friendly star bases. This title is very much an action-oriented take on the older turn-based computer game that pulls from not just Star Trek, but also Star Wars and Battlestar Galactica. Star Raiders saw its own share of praise, copycats, and spiritual successors. From VCS games like Star Master and Phaser Patrol to highly influential computer games like Elite, X-Wing, and Wing Commander. There was nothing like Stellar Track on the VCS when it came out in 1981, but folks who had access to an Atari computer had a more exciting option. And in 1982, no less than three clones in one official conversion of Star Raiders would show up on the VCS and really overshadow Stellar Track. The similarity was recognized at the time, too. The January 1983 edition of Electronic Fun with Computer and Games refers to Stellar Track as essentially a board game version of Star Raiders. Star Raiders and its clones also spelled the beginning of the end for Star Trek as a commercially sold game. All said that there were plans at Creative Computing to sell Super Star Trek on all the major computer platforms through their Sensational Software imprint, though these fell through as the computer market rapidly shifted towards more graphically impressive games, he himself noting that their top sellers were Air Traffic Controller and versions of Space Invaders and Breakout. This isn't to say that Star Trek didn't routinely reappear as commercial computer software, but these typically were more graphically intensive than what you found only a few years earlier. Eschewing the simple, turn-based original, some of these commercial products even pulled in real-time elements from variants like Trek 80 without going full-on Star Raiders. Perhaps the most blatant of these is the Famicom Disk System game Pulsar no Hikari, which plays very similarly to Star Trek save for the fact that in-sector movement and combat plays out in active real-time. Much as Richard Edwards indicated in Space Gamer, even if Star Trek is fun, it's hard to put it up against the increasingly elaborate and ambitious games from the 80s and expect it to be a viable commercial product without some changes. Even though game design moved rapidly beyond Star Trek, it's clear that the game was an early discovery for quite a few game developers throughout the game industry's life, meaning its roots run pretty deep in the field today. Liedem said that he'd received numerous letters from across the globe for decades after Super Star Trek was first published, in many cases by kids learning about computers and programming, who were asking for advice to convert the game to whatever platform they were running, wherein Liedem would routinely encourage them to experiment with the code and giving them suggestions if they had specific questions. It's hard to really quantify how many games were influenced in some way by Mayfield's original work on some base level as such. But this continued affection for the game by programmers has meant that Star Trek hasn't simply vanished. Rather, it continues to be converted to new platforms, each with their own twists on the formula just as in the 70s and 80s. Versions for C and Java have been floating around since the 2000s, and today you can even find it running on iOS or in internet browsers. Mayfield considers it one of the most widely converted computer programs ever written, next to the Hello World demo. It's a tall order to try and track down the evolution of every take on the game. Mayfield even considered revisiting his creation in recent years. He said he thought about entering a game jam based on converting his game to new computer languages using modern tools, thinking that he could do a quickie conversion in a day, but then realized that with all the new audio and visual bells and whistles he could do now, it would have likely taken up the whole summer again. And as this video has shown, Star Trek has gotten around with tweaks designed to take advantage of new technology or to simply cram it onto a platform that really has no business running it. Star Trek the game has in some ways followed the course of Star Trek the media franchise, which has similarly been rather ubiquitous over the past 55 years as of this recording, thanks both to officially produced materials and the fan works that have continued to pop up. And while Atari never did get that license, it may have worked out for the best. Stellar Track continues to pop up wherever Atari VCS games are being re-released without any licensing issues, making it one of the most accessible ways to play Star Trek today. If you've got one of these Atari collections that it's included with, a copy of the original cartridge, or just a hankering to boot it up an emulator, give it a whirl. Zdybel's implementation may not have all the bells and whistles of other variants, but the core game of Star Trek is still a lot of fun all these years later, and this conversion is an approachable way to experience it. Next time, it's your turn to be the Space Invader.